does things, because he gave me this word before I knew I was going to preach. And it's right in line with where God has our pastor in the book of Hebrews. He gave me the title first. And I didn't understand what it, I knew it went with something, but I didn't know what it went with. And when he started preaching a series out of Hebrews, and God had given me the scripture to match the title that he gave me, I said, God, you're awesome. He makes no mistakes. He always makes things cohesive. So if you would stand and meet me in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, and I'll be reading from the Amplified version, starting at verse 35. I'll give you a moment to get there. Verse 35, do not therefore fling away your fearless confidence, for it carries a great and glorious compensation of reward. For you have need of steadfast patience and endurance, so that you may perform fully, accomplish the will of God, and thus receive and carry away and enjoy to the full what is promised. For still a little while, a very little while, and the coming one will come, and he will not delay. But the just shall live by faith. My righteous servant shall live by his convictions, respecting man's relationship to God, and defying and divine things, and holy fervor born of faith and of faith conjoined with it. And if he draws back and shrinks in fear, my soul has no delight or pleasure in him. But our way is not that of those who draw back to eternal misery and are utterly destroyed, but we are those who believe, who cleave to and trust in and rely on God through Jesus Christ, the Messiah, by faith preserve the soul. You may be seated. And my title for my sermon today is Don't Diss Your Courage. You don't have the right to shrink back. Let me say that again. Don't diss your courage. You don't have the right to shrink back. Amen. And when you look at the, I looked up the word diss. I didn't even know it was in the Bible, I mean in the dictionary. This means something negative. Anytime you put this in front of it, it brings about a negative connotation. Disadvantaged, disjointed, disconnected. But without the this, it's positive, connected, jointed. So you get, you understand that? So when we look at the word, anything you put this in front of, it takes away from it, detracts, it subtracts. So the word that we're really dealing with is courage. So when you put this in front of it, you're discouraged. And the enemy seeks to discourage us all the time. So when you think things are happening and, oh, this is happening, it's the enemy. Because he seeks to discourage you. But if we are grounded in the word, we should be able to recognize when he is trying to discourage us. That's why it's titled, Don't Dish Your Courage. Because we give weight to the enemy when we agree and come in line with him. Because he's always on his job. And we have to be relentless on ours. We have to choose that even though things are going awry, and this is usually the little things, you know, because you can't find the keys, and you're late for work, and you're in traffic and somebody cuts you off. Those kinds of things. Those things are there to try to steal your joy. They're set up and designed that way. There's some things that happened on the way here. You think they did? It happened last night. I got my head wet taking a shower. And everybody know that my head got to be right. I said, devil, you a lie. I'm a hairstylist. I know how to fix it up. We gonna fix it. But I recognized who it was, and I kind of laughed. Like, I knew he was going to come some kind of way. But you know my head is everything. It's sweating like a Hebrew slave. And it's shrinking up, but God is still with me. So I recognize that it was the enemy trying to trick me and trap me and make me think that it's all about me. Even if it was curly, I had to wet it and wear it curly. We was gonna preach today. I would have preached in a scarf. But we was gonna preach today. But he sought to discourage me and make me back up on something small. Because I purpose to be cute. That is what I do. I purpose to be because I love me. So I purpose to look cute for me. But because it's not about me, I had to just go with it. Do what I could with it. It's sweating and carrying on, but we all right. But God is still God. So the enemy seeks to discourage us, and not always big things. So if we start to recognize the small things and see, the Bible says to be aware of the enemy's devices. And sometimes we're not aware. We just think, well, she's getting on my nerves. Well, no, it's a spirit behind it. And why is she getting on your nerve? Why don't you lower your nerve and she won't get on it? Because sometimes it's not them, it's you. God will show you through other people. I know because he did it to me. That's why I can stand here today and not kill you with my words. Because God had to strip me of some things and show me. So those things are designed to make you discouraged and to make you want to shrink back. Because life is hard. And it's harder when you don't know Jesus. And it's extra hard when you know him and you won't obey him. And it's extra hard. So we're going to look at a few things in these few passages of scripture that I want to kind of talk about. And looking at verse 35, when it says, do not therefore fling away your fearless confidence. And that's my first point. Don't fling it away. Don't be so easily to diss your courage. That's point number one. Don't diss your courage. Don't be so easy to throw away what God has already given you. You already had courage. You don't even realize how strong you actually are. Amen. What happens is we have by nature some strength. And when our strength runs out, we are to lean in and tap into the strength of God. And what happens when things come our way, we get discouraged and we forget that we need to lean on God. Because we run out, the strength of Chris ran out a long time ago. When divorce hit my life, when that tragedy and trauma hit my life, that strong Chris, she was gone. She was nowhere to be found. I was discouraged. I was broken. My pain had pain. My hurt had hurt. It hurt for me to breathe. And I had to literally, on my knees in my bathroom, cry out to God, God, I know you have not left me. I know you have not forsaken me. I know you love me even in this, because I was discouraged. I was broke. And the only thing that I could think of to stop that kind of pain, because it hurt for me to breathe in, it hurt for me to breathe out, was to stop breathing. But then I remembered his word. His word saved my life. Literally his word saved my life. God has not left me. God has not forsaken me. Even in this, he loves me. So even in your this, God still loves you. Don't throw away your courage. Don't throw in the towel. I know it's hard. Life is hard, but it's doable. So I had to decide, was I going to be diminished? Was I going to continue to shrink? Or was I going to be determined? And I got determined, because the natural part of me, there was still a little bit left, because you have to make a decision. One thing God will not take away from you is your power to choose. When I laid in that bed and at the point of depression, and he asked me, do you want to be made whole? I had heard that scripture in the Bible, but I didn't know where it was. Naturally, I said, yeah. He said, well, either you're going to be depressed, or you're going to be determined. I had at that moment make a decision to get up, get out of the house, and live. And I stand here today, I'm living. because I did not allow the enemy of my soul to make me give in and throw in the towel. And I'm no better than you. I'm no stronger than you. I'm no different from you. I just made a choice. And all of us have the power to choose. That's the one thing God will not do for you. He said, you choose this day. He will not take away your power to choose him. You have to make a decision. And I had to believe God over everything I thought, over everything I felt, over everything I saw. My circumstances were a wreck. I was getting $29 from the state with a mortgage that was over $1,000, with children, and light bill and gas bill and all these bills, and no money. And God said, trust me. Okay. Because I have already made a decision that I was going to obey God at every cost. Because the other way just wasn't working. As Willie John would say, God, I'm working for you, but I'm not. It was not working for me. So I made a decision that I was going to obey God. And it's going to cost you when you make that decision. It's going to cost you everything of your flesh. God had to clean some stuff up. We don't really know all the mess that we got on the inside. I mean, I see her, I can see her. And God said, yeah, when you see hers, well, let's deal with yours. What you talking about, God? But it was stinking. And if I did not allow God to process me through those processes, and they were processes, God was chiseling off stuff, getting rid of stuff, mindsets, my vocabulary, things that I thought were that just were not. Just dealing with the stuff that's on the inside of us that we don't even realize stinks. God was dealing with me. He was processing me, taking me through things. And when a sister said that to me, God is processing you, which I didn't want to hear at the time, all I could think of is, remember the conveyor belts where they make strimmings and you see the can spinning and dropping and getting sprayed on and all that kind of stuff? Well, that's what it felt like. That's what my life felt like. But what God showed me at the end of that process is that it's fit for distribution. So now I'm fit for his use. Because those things that were not of him, he couldn't use. I would kill you. My natural man, you asked me, I'm gonna tell you the truth. But I would just tell you, watch you bleed out, didn't care how it affected you, but I still can say the truth in love. God had to teach me how to do that. So I didn't have the right at that time when things were hard to shrink back and to diss my courage. I had to decide to keep going. And it's not an easy choice. I'm not trying to make it. That's why I'm telling you in my testimony. So you'll understand, I'm not making it up. I'm telling you what I did, not because I read it in here. God gave me the scripture after I went through it, before he gave it to me to preach. And I wrote in my Bible, you don't have the right to back up. I didn't have the right to back up because God had did too much. Even if he had left me in that state, he had done enough. So whatever it is that's going on in your life, don't diss your courage. The enemy does not have all power. He has some power. But we have the power over him. And because you're not operating in the power, only in your power, you're discouraged. So stop it. Cut it out. You say, you know Jesus. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. So on to my next point. And then I want to do a twofold because we're going to look at verse 36 and 38. For you have need of steadfast patience and endurance, so that you may perform and fully accomplish the will of God, and thus receive and carry away and enjoy to the full what is promised. Chapter 38. But the just shall live by faith. And that's the two things I want to deal with. Endurance and faith. Faith and endurance. Endurance and faith. You can't really have one without the other. The more you build your faith, the more you have endurance. Faith produces endurance. So the more you trust God, the more you're built up, the more you can stick and stay. So what is your faith? Not faith in you, not faith in the job, not faith in stuff, with people, places, and things, but faith in him. We take our eyes off him and we put our eyes on stuff, people, places, and things. Then we want to know why we don't have faith. You're putting your eyes on the wrong thing. When I had to believe that God could make me whole again, I had to believe him over the facts. Because I was hurt, that's a fact. Because I didn't have a job, that's a fact, because he told me not to work. Because my mortgage was almost two plus years in arrears, that was a fact. Let me see what else was going on. All kinds of stuff was going on. We were remodeling my home, and the joker stole the money, that was a fact. And I had to keep going back to God, but you see. But you see. And I gave him back his word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I kept having to give him back his word. And the more I gave him back his word, the more my faith grew. And I was able to stick and stay. And I was able to endure. Because it was hard. It was not easy. I'm not going to sell you no foolishness. It was hard. But it was doable. Because my faith wasn't in me. It was in him. Now, although they stole the money, my mom and her siblings, their inheritance house, for years my auntie wouldn't buy her out. And when she found out what was going on, she bought her out. So that's when we didn't know where the money was coming from. Who got $90-something thousand sitting around? What? Hello, God? Who has that just sitting around in my family? So we're living in a house, we've been there for the last, 5-6 years? So, but they had stole the money, everything stopped. But because I kept standing on the word, I was able to stick and stay. I could have just thrown the towel, all right, God, and it won't happen. And because I did tell God, well, you said for me to do all this stuff, so, and I told everybody what you said. So if it don't happen, it ain't my name at stake, it's yours. But I had to stand on what he promised me. And we've been in the house for 5 years. And I had to decide to endure hardship like a good soldier and not run like a pew punk. So stop being a pew punk, because you got the Holy Ghost living on the inside of you, which is power. So tap into your power, tap into me. If I tap into me, me and mom and the kids, we would be in an apartment somewhere. I had to tap into the thing that was real. The reality, because the truth, everything else was a fact, but the truth is his word. And we don't stand on the truth because we don't know no word. The Bible's not just for Sunday. So you need to get in your word so you can have something to stand on. Because if I stand on any other ground, it's sinking sand. If I had stood on anything other than the word, we were done. I was done. And all this was happening while I was still being made whole. This wasn't no cakewalk. When God asked me that question, he made sure that I could answer it truthfully. If he did not give me everything that I promised, would I still serve him? And when I say he kicked all the props, he kicked everything from up under me that was holding me, that I thought was holding me up. We got some warped ideas of what's holding us up. It's not your family, it's not your friends, it's not your job. But what happens when the job give you a pink slip? Your life over? Everything's done? Who are you when your friends walk away? Who are you if the husband or wife decide to leave? Who are you? Who are you? It's in the Word. We don't know who we are because we don't get in the Word. We believe everything that the enemy says. What I can't understand, okay, we know that the devil is a liar. We say, the devil is a liar. But then you believe everything that he says to you. Girl, the devil, he this and he that. And, oh, the devil is. Well, if he a liar, why are you upset about a lie? And you hold the truth. defeated foe. I read the end of the book. I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. So whatever you throw at me, bring it on. Because greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. I got power on the inside of me. I don't have to back up from no devil, no demon. I don't have to tremble at his voice. Because I know who I am. When I was in the world, I thought I knew who I was. In the world, I would fight anybody. Cuss anybody out. I wasn't scared of nothing. So now that I got him, what? Why would I back up from a devil when I got a Holy Ghost standing on the inside of me? That don't make no sense to me. So stop that. Telling me what the devil did, what the devil said. Well, he's a liar. So everything he said, then it's the opposite. So if he says I ain't gonna be nothing, oh my God. Hallelujah. Woo! That means I got destiny. So if he said that you ain't gonna be able to stand and preach, oh hallelujah, I'm gonna preach till the sun come down. So whatever he says, you already know that. Do you understand he is the inventor of lies? He invented them. But do you know who the truth is? Not facts. Facts are your emotions, your feelings. Facts can be changed. The fact locked him up. But DNA, the truth, set him free. So facts can change, but the truth never changes. And Jesus is the truth. He's the word. So if you stand on the truth of the word, you can build your faith and endurance. So on to my last point. And we're going to deal with 39. But our way is not of those who draw back. We are of those who believe. Who cleave to, trust in, rely on God through Jesus Christ the Messiah, and faith, the Messiah, and by faith preserve the soul. You don't know who you are in Christ. Your identity is distorted. Because if you knew who you were and who you are, you would never show. And it goes back to what I said, it's because you don't know the word. Or you know it, but you have chosen not to believe it. You've chosen to believe the lies that are whispered. And not just from the enemy, from you, that inner self chatter. Silence that. Stop calling yourself stupid. And stop calling yourself names. That's not who you are. You're the righteousness of Christ. So when it says we are not those, because they didn't realize who they were. And some of you don't. You're so busy trying to be you. Well, you know, a car don't have to try to be a car. It's already a car. The manufacturer knew just what he was making with the intention of in mind of it being a car. You were fearfully and wonderfully made. God had you in mind. You know, you're the only thing in creation that he touched, that he breathed himself into? Do you not know who you are? That's why you shrinking back, trying to throw in the towel. Stop it. This is something that God gave me to give to my children. I've been teaching them this over and over again. And we say it in singles ministry. And I want you to stand and I want you to say it with me. And I want you to, and we're going to do it slow. Because I want you to know who you are. And you repeat everything after me. I want you to internalize these words. I am wise.
I am full of godly wisdom.
I am excellent in my studies
and
all that I do.
I am fearfully
and wonderfully
made.
I am the head
and
not the tail.
I am above
and not
beneath.
I am the richer
and not
the poor. mind of Christ.
I am the mind of Christ.
The heart of Christ.
The heart of Christ.
The humility of Christ.
The humility of Christ.
The health of Christ.
The health of Christ.
The love of Christ.
The love of Christ.
The forgiveness of Christ.
The forgiveness of Christ.
Now this is the personal part. My worth.
My worth.
My value.
My value.
My significance.
My significance.
My self-esteem.
My self-esteem.
My self-respect.
My self-respect.
My acceptance.
My acceptance.
Is in Jesus Christ.
Is in Jesus
alone.
Christ.
I obey God.
I obey
and for
God.
The children and my parents.
Jesus loves me.
Say that again. Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
And I love myself.
And I love myself.
That's who you are. That's the word. You don't have to say. So anything else that you call yourself, that they call you, that the enemy says, is a lie. If it don't line up with what's in here, throw it away. I don't care how you feel. There's some mornings I get up and mad because I woke up. And I got to make a choice. What am I going to go with? My feelings or what I know? The joy of the Lord is my strength. And women, you know what I'm talking about. It's just like that some days, but we have to choose joy. We have to choose peace. It's given freely, but we have to choose it. Stop going with those feelings. Those are facts. If I go downstairs and come back up, I done felt about 5 things before I got downstairs, 5 more before I got back here. Which one is true? They're facts. But know who you are. Once you know who you are in Christ, you'll never shrink. It may be an idea, but you'll throw it away. Because I know who I am. And that's what I came to leave with you today. You do not have the right to diss your courage, nor the right to shrink back. Amen.